14. The Bible says, "And Jesus, when he had found that young ass, sat down, as it is written, 'Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh sitting on an ass's colt.'" Now, by way of introduction tonight, let me just sort of review real briefly what we learned about the entrance of Jesus, the triumphant entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem from our message this morning. As we looked at all four Gospels and compared them together, what we learned is that Jesus and his disciples came to a town by the name of Bethphage. And it was near Bethany. It's at the base of the Mount of Olives. And there at Bethphage, he gave a command to two of his disciples to go find an ass and a colt to bring them back to him. And ultimately, when they came back, they put some of their garments on one, and he mounted on the other, and he rode that up, elevation-wise, up to Jerusalem. As he was going, his disciples began to take palm tree branches and lay those out in front of the donkey, the ass, and the colt. And then, as they got closer to the city, more people joined the disciples, people who were not believers themselves, but people who had heard about Jesus, heard about the things that he had done, and were looking forward to him maybe being their earthly king and helping them get out from under the hand of the Roman Empire. They joined this crowd, and they began to also put down palm tree branches. And some, when they did not have a branch to put down, took their robes off and put them down on the street there or in the dirt for the animals to cross over. And Jesus triumphantly enters into Jerusalem with words such as we read here in verse number 13 being said, "Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord." Or, "Hosanna, blessed is the Son of David," as we read in another passage. He enters into the city of Jerusalem, and all of the city is focused on Jesus, which causes the Pharisees, that religious sect or section of Judaism, to be disturbed, because now the focus was on Jesus, this teacher, this carpenter's son, this one that they despised, along with the Sadducees and the scribes. And so the focus is turned to Jesus, and Jesus makes his way to the temple, where he dismounts the animal, he goes inside, and he sees the condition of the temple. Before returning back to the bottom of the hill that Jerusalem was located on and settling down in for the night in the city or town of Bethany. Now, with all that said, we notice here a passage of Scripture that is written for us from the Old Testament that's being quoted by John in verse 15. "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh sitting on an ass's colt." Now, let me have you turn back to Matthew, if I could. Matthew's account this evening. Matthew chapter number 21 and verse number 1. And here in just a minute, I'll give you the title for the thought tonight. But what I would like to do is similar to what we did in the message this morning. It's sort of using the Scripture, paint a picture. And I believe that the Scripture paints the picture well enough, so there's not much that I need to say, but just try to make sure that we put the pieces of the puzzle together. Paint a picture for us as Christians to realize the importance of reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ this week. And we see it even here in Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Notice Matthew chapter number 21 and in verse number 1. "And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage under the Mount of Olives, they sent Jesus two disciples." Then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, "Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied, and a colt with her. Loose them, and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, The Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Now notice back here, if you would, in verse number 3, that Jesus, as he sends out these two disciples, he tells them, when you go to this, go into the village and you find this this donkey, this ass, and the colt, its baby, that are tied up together, I want you to go in to get them, to untie them, to bring them unto me. And he says, if anyone asks you, if any man asks you what you're doing, why you're untying them or why you're loosing them, he says, this is what you tell them in verse 3, the Lord hath need of them. And ultimately, that is the title for our challenge tonight, is the Lord hath need of them. Notice in verse number 4 that it tells us that all of this was done that it might be fulfilled. Jesus, being the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior, fulfilled so many, I shouldn't say so many, he fulfilled all prophecies about the Messiah. But there are so many prophecies in the Old Testament about the Messiah. And he fulfilled every one of these. From his virgin birth, all the way up until his death and his burial and his resurrection on the cross of Calvary. Jesus fulfilled scripture after scripture after scripture. And ultimately, every Old Testament prophecy about the Messiah points to Jesus. That's why it's hard to fathom tonight that those that know the Old Testament prophecies, that the Jewish people themselves have a hard time receiving Jesus as the Savior because he did fulfill all these prophecies. Nonetheless, their eyes have been blinded, just as so many people's eyes have been blinded, to the fact that Jesus is the Savior, the Messiah, the Christ. Well, the Bible tells us here that he needed something. That the Lord needed something. He needed this colt, this little baby donkey. But not only that donkey, that little baby donkey, that colt, he needed the mother as well. He needed the mother donkey, the mother ass, the Bible tells us, because he needed to fulfill a scripture that's given to us in Zechariah 9:9. It was one of our verses for our sword drill. If you have your Bible, go ahead and hold your place here in Matthew, and just turn back there to Zechariah so you can see it for yourself. Zechariah chapter number 9, towards the end of the Old Testament, and verse number 9. It says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. Now, Jesus was to fulfill this prophecy right here. Interestingly enough, the Jewish people were told that their Messiah would come riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the offspring, the baby, the child, you could say, of that mother, of that donkey, of that ass. So back to Matthew chapter number 21, Jesus needed these two animals. He needed them in order to fulfill Scripture. Now the Bible tells us in all four of these Gospels about the fact that Jesus rode in to Jerusalem upon an ass. However, in Mark's Gospel and in Luke's Gospel, the emphasis is put on the colt. Let me just show you here real quickly, and if you want to bookmark your page there in Matthew, we'll come back to it. Turn over first to Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter number 11 and verse number 4. It says, and they went their way and found the colt tied by the door without in a place where two ways met. And they loosed him. And certain of them that stood there said unto them, what do ye loosing the colt? And they said unto them, even as Jesus had commanded, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him, and he sat upon him. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. Then in Luke chapter number 19 and in verse number 28, Luke chapter number 19 and verse number 28 actually is where this story starts, but we'll skip down to verse number 33 where it says, and as they were loosing the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, why loose ye the colt? And they said, the Lord hath need of him. And they brought him to Jesus, and they cast their garments upon the colt, and they set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. So, going back to Matthew now here, and we're in chapter 21, verse number 5, or verses 3, 4, and 5, we're told that the Lord had need of them. We're told that the Lord had need of these two animals. In Mark's gospel and in Luke's gospel, they focus on the colt. And the reason behind this is because Jesus tells them about this colt that it would be an animal that never a man sat upon. Now, what is the significance of that, one might ask? Well, when you look back to the Old Testament, we're told about animals that if they were going to be used for any kind of sacred purpose, then they couldn't be domesticated. And they couldn't be used, or they could not have been used for agricultural purposes. In other words, they should never have had a yoke put upon them. If they never had a yoke put upon them, if a man never sat upon them, then they were considered sacred. They were used for a sacred purpose. In Numbers chapter 19, verse number 2, and Deuteronomy chapter 21, and verse number 3, we're told this about the heifers, that if they did not have a yoke put upon them, if they were not domesticated and had never been sat upon, then they were a special sort. Jesus needed that colt because that colt had never been sat upon by a man. It had not been domesticated, it had not been yoked, it had not been used for agriculture, and so this colt was special. Now, as I said, Mark and Luke look and focus at the colt. Their Gospels, as I mentioned in one of the messages this morning, do not disagree with Matthew's Gospel. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all work together to give us a clearer picture. Mark and Luke focus on the one that was not domesticated, the one that was considered sacred. But here in Matthew chapter 21, Jesus told the disciples that he sent, the two that he sent, tell them that the Lord hath need of them. And so he had need not only of the colt that had never been yoked and never been sat upon, but he had need of the ass, the mother of this colt. These two disciples go, and they bring these two animals back to Jesus. And when they get them to Jesus, garments are put upon them, and Jesus mounts up on that colt that has never been ridden by a man, and is taken into Jerusalem, or up to Jerusalem. And ultimately, by sitting upon that colt, rather than upon its mother, upon the ass, it signifies that there was something special about Jesus. That colt was sacred. Now, with all that said, the picture that is painted for us this evening, as I said, is a beautiful picture. Because tonight the Lord hath need of them. Who am I talking about? I'm talking about those that have yet to be reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Lord hath need of them. Some of them are little and young. And they, unlike their parents, have never been yoked. They haven't been domesticated by Satan. They have not been used in the work of the world. They have not been tarnished by the things of this life. And so unlike their parents, they are still pure and holy. And they have a whole life ahead of them to look forward to. But Jesus doesn't just need the little ones. The Lord also has need of the ass as well, the donkey, the one that has been yoked, the one that has had a life that it has lived, and maybe it's been a tough life. It's been a life of service, it's been a life of bondage, it's been a life of turmoil. The Lord has need of that individual too. Some might say, well, preacher, I don't really know if that's a nice thing to compare people to animals like donkeys. Let me stop you if you think that for a moment, and encourage you to look back to the Old Testament, because mules or donkeys were actually held in high favor in the Old Testament. In the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 1, where it told the story of Solomon and how that Solomon was coronated to be the king after his father David, and what he rode upon was a donkey or an ass. In the book of Judges, we're told about the use of the mules, the donkeys, and how that they were once again held in high esteem as far as an animal, being an animal that could labor and work and do much. So this is not a derogatory thing. We know the story of Balaam and the donkey. And in the story of Balaam and the donkey, where Balaam is going to go against the people of God and curse the people of God, we know who the real donkey was. We know it was Balaam, because he was going to make a mistake. His donkey, that or mule that he was riding upon, actually spared his life. So back to the picture, the painting that's been painted for us in the Scripture. The Lord hath need of these people. He hath need of the donkey, the mule that has had a difficult life, and he has need of that young individual that has their whole life ahead of them. For what purpose? Well, what was the purpose for these two animals here in this story? It was to bring the Lord Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. Not for him to walk into Jerusalem, as he did the very next day when he went into the temple and cast out the money changers and the merchants. To carry him, to elevate him, so that as he walked in, people saw him as someone special. Some called him a prophet. Others called him the son of David. And still yet others said the king. And that is the result, is when God is able to be brought into the life of one of these individuals, whether it be that adult or that teenager who's lived a rough life, or be that child who has their whole life ahead of them, when Jesus comes into their life and he becomes their Savior, then he is exalted to those around them. And he is seen as king, as someone special. We can all give testimony tonight as Christians of what Jesus did for us. How he changed our lives, some of us when we were young, and some of us once we had lived our lives a bit, maybe with some regrets of things we had done and wish we could change. Yet Jesus needs both in order for him to be exalted. With that said tonight, the challenge for us is this. That you may be saved, and I may be saved, and there may be those out there that need to be reached, so that Jesus can be exalted. So, will we go and find them? In Matthew 21, once again, we're told here, in verse number 1, that Jesus sent two disciples. If you read all four of these gospel accounts, you will find that not one of the authors mentions who these two disciples were. We don't know why, but when we get to heaven, I believe we'll find out it's because the Lord did not want us to compare ourselves and say, well, I'm not really a Peter, and this was Peter that did this. Or for someone to say, well, I'm not really an Andrew, and Andrew is the disciple that did this. These are two unnamed disciples. I can almost categorically tell you that one of them was not Judas, that's for sure. I'm pretty confident that Judas Iscariot was not one of the two. But out of the other 11, it could have been any of the other 11. There are these two, unnamed. Why? So that we could relate to them 2,000 years later. The Lord sent them, and he has sent us. Now, I want you to think about the rest of this picture real quickly this evening. These two disciples, unnamed disciples, are sent to go into the village. And Jesus tells them, when you go into the village, you're going to find a mule, an ass, and you're going to find that mule's colt. They're going to be tied together. And I want you to go in and I want you to loose them and to bring them back to me. Now, that takes some faith. But you know, anybody can walk into a city or into a town or a village and just sort of look around and see if what Jesus said was true. There's one commentator on the Bible that says that he doesn't necessarily believe that this was a miracle of the Lord, that this may have been prearranged by the Lord. I would disagree wholeheartedly. And the reason why is, Jesus didn't have to prearrange anything to fulfill Scripture. Amen. He fulfilled Scripture because He was the Word of God, the Word dwelling in flesh. So there was no reason for Him to go into this town and prearrange it. He was the Son of God. He knew that those animals were there. And ultimately, He sends them in there to that village. And these two disciples look around, and they see that mule, and they see that mule's colt. Now, they have to take another step of faith. We got to actually go over there and unloose them. Now, I don't know what the punishment was. I can't remember what it was in the Old Testament. But I know in the Old West, if you stole a man's horse, you were in trouble. You didn't just go in and take a man's animal. Especially if it was one that he used for work. But they were told, go in and just untie these animals. Now they have to take this next step of faith. It's one thing to go into the village and to look around. But then when you find them, to now take that next step of faith and go over there and actually start loosing them from whatever they were tied to. And then Jesus told them, He says, hey, if anybody asks you what you're doing, you just tell them the Lord hath need of them. I can imagine being one of those two disciples and thinking to myself, I hope nobody asks me. Let's just untie them. Let's get out of here before anybody asks us what we're doing. And all of a sudden they're asked. If you read the other accounts in Mark and in Luke, Mark tells us that there were some that were sitting nearby that said, hey, wait, why are you loosing the colt? And guess what Luke tells us? These people that asked this were the owners of the colt. Hey, what are you doing with those two animals? Us? You're asking us? Well, now they had to take the next step of faith. They actually had to speak the words that Jesus told them to speak. They couldn't add their own words because their words didn't have power. Their words were the words of man. They had to speak the words of Jesus. They had to tell them what Jesus said and let Jesus' words be good enough. And so they said, the Lord hath need of them. Oh, okay, the Lord. All right, go ahead. Could you imagine them walking away with them thinking, wow, that was too easy. How in the world did that happen? If it would have been Judas Iscariot, he might have said, let's go back and talk to the bank. And say, the Lord hath need of this. Amen. Because we know the greed that he battled with. But the point is they had to step out by faith and go into the city, the village, and look around. They had to take that next step of faith and actually unloose them. They had to take that next step of faith and actually call Jesus. It would have been easy for those two disciples to just tie the colt and the mule back up and say, you know what, we thought these were our animals. Sorry about that. But no, they spoke the words of Jesus and they take the animals and lead them back to Jesus. And if they had not done that, Jesus would have no mule or no colt to ride upon to enter into the city of Jerusalem and to be exalted before the world of Jerusalem. With that said, this week, as we go out, we have to just by faith follow the Lord. Go where He tells us to go, do what He tells us to do, say what He tells us to say.
Yes.
And trust that He knows what He's doing. And then ultimately, He's going to use it all for His honor and glory to get what He needs. He needs some lives tonight to be saved. What does the Bible say about why Jesus came in Luke 19:10? To seek and to save that which was lost. That was the whole goal for Him coming to this earth. The whole focus of our lives this week, though we have so many things on our plate, as parents, as young people, we have school, we have work, we have extracurricular activities, we have church Wednesday night, we have so many things going on, but still the focus as we go into this week ought to be souls. Reaching souls with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You never know what individual you might come across that is in need. I shared the story this morning in the Sunday School Hour, so I don't want to repeat the whole thing, but I'm thankful that the last couple of weeks as we've gone out door knocking, and those that have been able to come, I mean, they're rejoicing along with me that we've been able to see a young girl come last week in Dakota, and then last week and this week we've seen Linda come both times, and hopefully next week we will see a man that we met just yesterday who lost his wife in January. I can't tell you the whole story about how he lost his wife because it's very personal and it's not my place to tell you. But I'll say this, it was very tragic. It wasn't natural. A man that was hurting and sat there, or I should say stood there in the driveway and talked to my wife and I for probably a good 20 or 30 minutes. He's saved. He has a testimony of salvation. But he needs to have that relationship with Jesus strengthened. Why? So that Jesus can be exalted in his life, and so that others that he meets can know that Jesus is the King. There are people out there like that, all around us. That some that have a life of bondage, some that are young and have yet to live that life of bondage, and we have the opportunity to bring them to the Master. But it all requires us stepping out by faith. And so let me challenge you this week to once again, go where Jesus wants you to go, do what Jesus wants you to do, and say what Jesus wants you to say. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to see this world the way